Nodes are the building blocks of your AI with Unity behavior. Controlling which nodes execute and when they execute is a fundamental component of making engaging game AI. In this video, you're going to learn about all of the flow control nodes in Unity behavior today to help you get your game AI up and running fast. Hey, Chris here from LlamAcademy, here to help you.
Ooh, me?
Yes, you! Make your game dev dream become reality by showing you the ropes of a new behavior graph tool, Unity Behavior. Unity Behavior is a node-based editor to help you build a behavior graph, which is a more powerful version of a behavior tree. We'll get a little bit more into why that is a little bit later in this video. These graphs are constructed by connecting a series of nodes together to get your desired behavior. And there are two main high-level types of nodes. First is action nodes. These are the most common types of nodes that will be in your behavior graph. They tell your AI agent to perform some task. And these can be very simple, like, hey, stop moving, or as complex as you'd really like to make them. Then we have flow control nodes. These control how we execute those different actions and when we will execute them. There are a few categories of flow control nodes, and we'll talk about those as we go through. And now, before we jump in to start looking at this in Unity, if you haven't already used Unity Behavior and you're looking for a high-level overview of what Unity Behavior is and how to use it, I'd recommend you check out my other video, Introduction to Unity Behavior, which I've got a link in the description and a card on the screen for. All right, now let's take a closer look at all of these flow control nodes. I've opened up the sample scene from Unity Behavior, which has an example graph. This is a great starting point because it has a set of action nodes that we can play around with different control flow nodes with. Unity Behavior is designed to read like a story, so we can easily identify what will happen just by looking at the graph. We can read it top down, left to right. So here we can clearly see the agent here, self, will say, what should I do? And then we'll pick a random branch beneath this. We'll either say, self says, let me think about it, wait for 1 second. Or we'll say, move to target location, pick a random target from any object in the scene tagged with targets. That target will say, pick me, and then this agent will move to that target. This random is a control flow node. It will control whether we go to the left branch or to the right branch. We can have as many different branches underneath this as we'd like, and this random node will just continually pick from all of those. But there are many different control flow nodes. If we just press space and come to flow with the purple icon, we can see there are quite a few. We're going to go through all of these today. Let's start with sequence. This one will execute from left to right. So if we remove these two edges from random going down and the one coming into it, instead take self says what should I do to the sequence, and then sequence to let me think about it, and then also sequence to move to a target location. Now, if we were to run this, it will always execute this one on the left and then the one on the right. In fact, why don't we do just that and turn on debug so we can see as it executes what happens. We can see what should I do, let me think about it, wait for 1 second, and then move to a target location, and the second sequence is executed. Once that completes, it will restart from the top and repeat in this order forever. And a pro tip, the cluster of nodes underneath our sequence, the ones that have that little box surrounding them, is also a sequence. This is a really convenient way to group action nodes together so you don't have to connect each one with an arrow. To create one, all you have to do is drag one action node on top of another, and it will automatically create this sequence. A node that behaves similarly to sequence is one called try in order. If we just replace sequence with try in order, what this will do is still execute them from left to right, but if one of these succeeds, it will not execute the next one in the sequence. So if we click play, what do you expect would happen? That's right, it's only ever going to execute the left one because nothing in there will fail. Now these three flow control nodes are allowing us to take multiple edges out down beneath it. Not all control flow nodes do this. In fact, most of them can't. If we were to go back to flow, and pick one such as repeat, once we connect one of these branches, and then we try to connect the second one, we're prompted with this pop-up to say, hey, you can't do that because this one doesn't support multiple branches underneath it. You need to pick one of these and connect your nodes from there. In here, we see all the ones we just saw, sequence, random, try and order, but there are a few new ones, such as run in parallel, which in this case wouldn't make a lot of sense. However, these run in parallel are very powerful because it allows us to define discrete behaviors and execute them simultaneously. You can think of these as working similar to having multiple mono behaviors on the same game object, both with their own update loop. They're all still running on the main Unity thread, but they're happening in parallel, kind of. Run in parallel will execute all of the branches that you connect underneath it. Run in parallel until any succeeds will obviously stop once one succeeds. And run in parallel until any fails, and run in parallel until any completes work the exact same way with just those different conditions. You can change this parallel mode in the inspector with this dropdown. If we close this, we can see, okay, we can repeat any branch that we'd like, and we can even assign conditions. When should we repeat? If we take this repeat and bring up the inspector, it defaults to forever. But we can say it should repeat until success, fail, or on arbitrary conditions. This is quite powerful and gives us a lot of flexibility built in. Another really interesting flow control node is the cooldown. If we were to set up a try and order that goes to a cooldown with a 5-second cooldown, and then that move to target location, and the second branch being the let me think about it, if we click play, what this does is throttles how frequently we will choose to move to a target location. The first execution will take that agent and make them move. However, the second execution, it will determine that that cooldown is not yet elapsed. So we will force let me think about it. It's important to note that this cooldown is based on when it executes, not when all of its children execute. That's why we see the second loop execution can come back to move to a target location again. A similar time-based node is the timeout node. If we set this to timeout after 3 seconds, remember, because we're using try and order, the left one will always be the priority. It will start executing, and after 3 seconds, it will abort execution. You'll see that it didn't really move the agent at all. And then they say, oh, okay, well, let me think about it. This is very useful if you have long running tasks that we need to cap how long they should run for. Now, speaking of aborts, there's also a direct abort node. With the abort node, it's called abort if, we can assign any list of conditions. And whenever any of those are true or all of those become true, it will cancel execution of all of the nodes beneath it. This is extremely powerful and I use it a lot. One really good example is if a player is setting a destination for an agent to move to, and then they click somewhere else to set a different location. You'd want the agent to be responsive and stop moving and start moving to the new location. That can be achieved very easily with the abort if, a variable value changed condition, and if your target location has changed, then it would abort. Similarly, under abort, we have restart. So you don't have to abort the entire tree. We can just restart the tree and that behaves the exact same, except instead of immediately stopping, it will restart from this node. If you're getting value out of this video, go ahead and drop a like and share this out with a friend who would also get value out of this video. I'm hoping the series on Unity behavior will raise awareness for this underpromoted free tool, and I need your help to do that. There's not just these purple flow controls though. We can see under flow, we have conditional. We have a conditional branch and a switch. So for a branch, we can assign again arbitrary conditions in the inspector if any or all are true, and we can assign as many conditions as we'd like to check. For example, if we would say variable condition, variable comparison, if some condition is true, let's make them say, let me think about it. If that condition is false, then we might move to a target location. Now, one thing that makes Unity behavior much more powerful than your standard behavior tree is you might want them to execute both of these. Maybe only when the condition is true, you want them to say, let me think about it, but regardless, you want them to move. With a normal behavior tree, you basically have to duplicate this right side underneath the left side as well. But with Unity behavior, we can take self says, let me think about it directly over here into this other sequence, and it will prompt us to insert a join node. Wait for any or wait for all. Wait for any allows us to say, if we come through either of these two branches above, we're still gonna do the below. If we have something like wait for all, that doesn't really make sense on a conditional because you would never execute both the true and false case at the same time. Wait for all is very useful in parallel executions when you want all of the branches to have to complete before we move on. Similar to the condition, in some cases, we have an enumeration and we want to do discrete different things based on a particular value. That's where the switch comes in. This allows you to select any enumeration that you have tagged with a blackboard enum attribute, or you can create new ones right here in Unity behavior. On the blackboard, you can go plus enumeration, create a new enum type, quickly create that, and it'll generate a script for you. Then once you have it on your blackboard, you can hook up to the switch and it will generate nodes for each of those potential options. Then from each node, you can route to whichever branch you need. And because again, this is a behavior graph, we can join multiple of these together with something like await for any. And while this graph doesn't particularly make sense, this shows some of the power of it being a graph and not strictly a tree. We're almost through all of the built-in control flow nodes now. We have an inverter and a succeeder. I'm not 100% sure on either of these what the use cases are, but what the inverter does is inverts the return status of the nodes beneath it. If we assume that self says, let me think about it, cannot fail, nor can wait for 1 second, that means that this left side will always fail because both nodes here will always return success. Conversely, on the right side, with a succeeder, it forces the return of the entire branch underneath it to be success. So with this setup, we would expect that this behaves very much the same like a sequence where it will execute the left side because this will become failed at the end and move over to the right where it will always succeed. Even if one of these nodes were to say that it failed, this would still say it succeeded. In this video, we've covered all of the control flow nodes that are there today in Unity Behavior on version 1.0.7. You can also create your own if these don't suit your purpose, but I've really never come across the need to do that. The built-in ones let me do literally everything I've ever tried to do. If you're looking to learn more about Unity Behavior and see more examples of different things we can do, I've got 2 really big projects in the works that I'm really excited to share with you coming soon. Make sure you're subscribed so you're notified whenever these come out. And let me tell you, you're gonna wanna know when they come out. If you're looking for ways to support LlamAcademy because you're getting so much value out of these videos, you can get yourself some LlamAcademy merch right here on YouTube. You can use the affiliate links down in the description to do your Humble Bundle or Asset Store shopping. Both of those give me a small percentage of the purchase price at no additional charge to you, or you can make a recurring contribution as a YouTube member or a Patreon supporter. Both of those will get your name up here at the screen at the end of every video. You get access to a private members exclusive Discord where you can share any projects that you're working on, ask any questions, or just generally chat. At the awesome tier, there's Ivan, Ifiopoulos, Jason Hansen, Angel, Sneddon, Trey Briggs, Will B, Mustafa, Nick5454, and Pixel Wizards. There's also all of these great supporters as well. Thank you all for your support, and I'll see you on the next video.